Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the comparative beer tasting between English styles and American styles. I was particularly looking forward to this event on the stage because we have two very, very esteemed beer connoisseurs from England and from Germany on stage. And I'd like to welcome Sylvia Kopp and Pete Brown. Give them a hand.
Wow.
So, as usual, perhaps we start with an introductory round, and you can say a few words about yourselves and what brought you here.
I'm... Do you want to go first?
No.
I'm Pete Brown. I'm a British beer writer.
Beer
fan. And I've got four British beers for you to try. I'm not even going to say that they're going to be better than the American beers, because they're not. Well, some of them are. Some of them might be. And some will go down to personal taste.
That's funny because, I've also got four delicious beers, but talking about deliciousness, actually, I always found English beers totally interesting. It's just a shame in Germany we don't get them that much. One thing is probably true, American craft beers seem to tend to be more flavor forward. So we will see, and you will see. I hope you come with us and join us in this tasting.
We have four different beer styles, which were all British in origin, which the Americans have taken and made their own and done different things to those styles. And so now we have some traditional and not so traditional British beers based on these styles, some of which are hundreds of years old, and then more modern American interpretations of those styles.
That's right. And we start on the sunny side of things. Do you already have our beers? No. And we get darker. Dark does not necessarily mean heavy, but with the last beer we will also become fairly heavy. So shall we reveal what we have? The first style, what's it?
I guess our first style is kind of pale ale, often crossing over in Britain with a relatively new style called golden ale. What's the difference between golden and pale? Who knows? This is just the way that styles develop. But these beers are obviously quite pale, almost lager coloured sometimes. And they've been, I guess, from a British perspective, what we had recently was dark brown ales were the traditional British drink. And then people moved to lager in the 1970s, 1980s. And then about 15 years ago, some brewers started to brew very pale ales as a way of attracting lager drinkers back into ale. And so I've got an example like that. But then when this was happening in the UK, we called them golden ales, not pale ales, because pale ale was a very old-fashioned style. It was the kind of thing your granddad would drink in a pub. And it had no appeal to younger drinkers.
And pale ale was anything but brown, so it could
exactly.
be amber colour.
It could
right?
be any colour. But pale ale in the US, for the last 30 years, has just become a completely new phenomenon.
Drink, right. I have an American pale ale here, and the very famous icon and the very first pale ale ever, and that's really also respected in the whole American... In the entire American brewing industry is the Sierra Nevada Pale Ale. It came out in the 1980s, and it launched the whole hop wave we have. The whole thing with the hops that's going on was really created by this one beer and this one new hop breed. So when we talk about this, we also need to talk about hops. And in the traditional European culture, hops were like what, Pete? What traditional European hops like?
So restrained. I think hops are a product of the countries they come from.
Yeah.
So British hops are like walking down a narrow country lane when it's raining. The smells of earth and loam
wow.
and spice. German hops are aloof and aristocratic.
Right
and kind of
on.
Like, yes, we are noble hops. We're not going to kind of mess with the likes of you. Refined, delicate,
that's
subtle.
Right.
And then you go to America, and the hops are massive.
Exactly. I'd like to add, thank you, Pete. when you talk to brewers, before these new American massive hops came along, a beer should not be fruity. The hop character should not turn out to be fruity or flowery. You had this herbal character, a little bit pininess, a hint of citrus, and that's the noble kind of thing, some herbs maybe. And then Cascade came along. This was a new breed in from the US, the Cascade hops, and they were had lots of bitterness, lots of alpha acids, but also this fruitiness in terms of grapefruit and some flowery notes and piney notes. So there's lots of going on, and we had this then in a beer. And Sierra Nevada and Ken Grossman said, okay, I want to brew with these hops. And for his purposes, he just took the samples that were handed out to brewers to do it, experiment with it. And so Sierra Nevada Pale Ale was born. What I have here is Drum Roll, a recent release from Odell Brewing in Colorado. And I hope we can do a comparative tasting. Do you have two beers? Do you have the two beers already? Or
I think you've had the Odell, and you're drinking very quickly. This is good to see. And you've now got the Thornbridge. But do you want to talk to us about the Odell?
I do not know much of it. They don't give you the hop variety. But as you can tell, there is a very slim character and has some crispy bitterness and astringent finish. And it's overly fruity. That's what it is. Maybe in the smell you get more dankness. Dank is a new word for using lots of hops that reminds you of the German word could be compost or more earthy notes. You smile. I know what you're thinking of. But then the taste, the whole fruitiness comes through. They didn't give me the hop formula, but I think the structure makes it very clear. It's some residual sweetness in the beginning, and then a very crisp, almost sharp feeling on the tongue when it finishes on an astringent, bitter note.
It says on the back of the Odell can that these are rock star hops. And that is a typical...
Really?
Yeah, if you just say
they... They don't tell... Oh, so, I haven't...
You know, we won't tell you what varieties they are, but they just say that they're rock star hops.
Do you know that variety?
I have no idea what's... But I guess it's the Big C ones. I guess it's Chinook, yeah. Cascade, Citra. It tastes like that. And this is the thing that American craft beers have done. They've made hops into stars. People now chase particular hop varieties. If you taste the Wild Swan, the hoppiness in there is much more restrained. It's much more balanced. You can get more of the malty backbone because the hops are more recessive. This is the character of a traditional British beer. I think the difference is that beer culture in Britain, similar to Germany, is that it's about going to a pub or a bar and drinking a lot of volume. So this beer is 3.5%. This is a beer that you can drink 2 pints at lunchtime and go back to work, responsibly, of course. It's a beer that you drink. Britain for a long time was about drinking quantity and about finishing a pint and then wanting another one.
3.5, 5.3. And I think, nevertheless, the smell in here is deliciously citrusy.
It is. It's much more restrained than the Odell's. And it's harder to kind of find out. But this is a mix of American and British American and European hops.
That's right.
And the thing is that British brewers now use no more American hops than they use British hops. The influence from American craft brewing is really permeated to British styles now. And so this is almost something of a hybrid between a traditional British beer with some American influence.
Yeah, I like both very much, but I'm always amazed how much taste you get out of such a low ABV. I mean, we are here almost at the level of Berliner Weiss. Cheers. And it's amazing. And still here, you have much more maltiness, a thicker texture compared to that one. Texture, mouthfeel. And yet, I would still say this is a refreshing drink. So
are we going to have our second beer? I think... our second beer would be our second pairing, I guess. Our second pairing is about the style that has defined international craft beer. India Pale Ale was first brewed in the UK, roughly around the mid 18th century. It was brewed for a long time before it was called India Pale Ale. It went to India. It became very popular with the British working there. There's a story, which I'll try and tell very briefly, which is the British working in India, soldiers and diplomats. The local drink was called arak, which you make by cutting into a palm tree. You get the sap, you ferment the sap. The really best quality arak would only send you blind. The first European deaths in this part of the world were from people drinking themselves to death. They needed some really, really good quality booze that was strong. And so India Pale Ale went there.
It must have been boring in your colonies.
It was so boring. It was short periods of intense violence punctuated by long periods of nothing happening whatsoever. Right. And so people used to drink themselves into a stupor in the other times. So India Pale Ale had to be a strong, assertive, alcoholic, heady beer. And what happened to India Pale Ale in the UK after the end of the empire, after the end of India, was it became a much debased beer. It became weaker beer. It became a less flavorful beer. It became just an ordinary British bitter until American craft brewers picked up on the style and said, hey, this is the best style to showcase our wonderful hops.
That's right. But wasn't it true that it, even then, at that time, 100 years ago, it was an international style? So in all of the Commonwealth, you could find pale ales and India pale ales. And so it's not really true that the new IPAs, India Pale Ales, in the US referred to UK examples. What craft brewers, especially Sierra Nevada, Kent Grossman, and Anchor Steam, the first ones who did the style, what they said was, they remembered there was an IPA in the US available, which was called Ballantine's IPA. And they still had this in memory, and they knew it was much more bitter, and they wanted to brew a beer like that. So they didn't go all the way back to the UK, even though there's no doubt that English beers were the first inspiration for American craft on the whole. But for that particular style, in the 1980s, they referred to their own IPA, and there were still some bottles of Ballantine's around at that time.
So which one did we get first? Have we got the proper job just now? Okay. So this is a classic example of this transatlantic game of passing the tennis ball, which happens in international craft brewing. So one of the first American craft brewers to perfect IPA as a style was Bridgeport Brewing in Portland, Oregon. And last time I went to Bridgeport 10 years ago, it was still a beautiful example of an IPA. Not so much anymore. Now the ownership's changed. But Bridgeport worked with the British brewer, St. Austell, and Bridgeport taught St. Austell about American hops, while St. Austell taught Bridgeport about cask ale. So this is a very kind of transatlantic corporation beer. And this is very similar to what Bridgeport IPA used to taste like when it was good. This is a real transatlantic beer. It's kind of half American, half British. So I'm kind of cheating by putting it in as a British beer to show off against an American beer. This beer wouldn't exist without the American influence, but it's a damn sight better than the IPAs that existed in Britain until the American influence came across.
Mm. Very nice. So,
and these guys are in Cornwall. They love American hops. This is, even the ingredients are a great example of international cooperation. So the hops are Willamette, Chinook, and Cascade, classic American Northwest hops. The malt is Marisotto malt, which is classic British ale malt. And that malt has the power, has the strength, it has the backbone to stand up to American hops. So you're not just getting a flash of hop character. You're getting real balance there.
And if maybe English brewers turn more to American hops, I can say that I still see Maris Otter malts a lot in American breweries. So this, they get their malts from the UK, and this seems to be true. It's still a nice backbone also for their beers. This IPA, Escape to Colorado, is a new one from last year. It's got 6.2 ABV and 55 IBUs only. And they give you the hop formula in this case. It says Mosaic and Apollo. Apollo is a bittering hop. It's there for the ground, the ground bitterness. And Mosaic is a nice new breed for aroma flavoring. And if I don't know if you can distinguish, they are known for their blueberry and bubblegum character. Also a little bit papaya. But what Mosaic also is known for is that they add texture to the beer. So if you have a creamy finish, that can come from the hop oils in here.
That's a lot more resiny than the British beer. We've got some nice tropical fruit characters in the British beer, which are from the American hops. But they do more than tropical fruit, and I think in that one you've got that sort of resiny.
That's kind of right. And still in the finish, something creamy, soft slides in. It's resiny, it's mouth drying, astringent, but there was also some other thing going on just when you swallow it. So it's also slightly hazy, whereas this is so brilliant, and it's also brilliant on the tongue, I think.
Yeah.
The proper.
It's a very nicely made beer. The whole thing about hops is the thing that characterizes craft beer today. Hops are only one of the four ingredients in beer, and I do think we should look at the other ones, but hops are the ingredient that people get most passionate about. And there's a lot of reasons for that, which we don't have time to go into. But American hops have this different flavor palette, as I said earlier, than British or European hops do. And a lot of people have said, well, if you're putting these kind of hops in a British IPA, it's not a traditional IPA because we never used American hops. American hops are new, we didn't have them. And that's not true. In the heyday of IPA in the 1850s, 1870s, Britain could not grow enough hops. Uh-huh. And they used American hops because they had to. But they complained about the horrible flavors of American hops. Mm-hmm. The things that we love now, that resin, that tropical fruit, the reason we drink these beers, 100 years ago, people would have said, ah, that's not like beer, that's horrible. And so we would age these beers mm-hmm. for a year in wooden casks mm-hmm. in order to get rid of those terrible hop aromas. Yep. Yep. And now American craft brewers do everything they can to refrigerate the beers, to preserve those aromas.
Yeah,
and it's, our taste has completely
isn't
changed.
Isn't that a contradiction? But it's true, IPAs do not travel well. But the way they originated, this was a travel style, right? I think it's funny.
Those hop characters were meant to disappear. We didn't like them. And I found old records from brewers talking about how American hops are not suitable for making pale ales and IPAs. But now we only want pale ales with American hops.
Yeah, but hop growers keep up in Germany. We've got new hop varieties, probably in the UK too, right?
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
That match the American qualities.
And I just found some research that shows that we used to grow hops with these qualities in the UK, mm-hmm. and we bred those qualities out of British hops because they were undesirable. So now we've come full circle and taste changes. We're going to move from hoppy beers to beers that are much more defined by their malt character now. There's a global hop shortage, so if any of you are brewers, I would recommend that moving to flavors defined by malt is a pretty good idea at the moment.
Yeah, and it becomes much, much darker. And we deal with stouts now, of course.
Yep, so I think the first one being poured is the English one, so I'll just talk about that. So for me, malting is one of the many miracles of beer. Barley is a blonde-coloured grain that is harvested in a field. That grain is then dried, and the degree to which you then roast it or dry it when you're finishing the malt determines the colour and character of the beer. So the malts in these beers are very, very gently dried, just with a light application of heat. Then you get something that looks like this. It's the same grain, but dried much more harder, much more aggressively. And if you think about when you toast coffee beans, the darker they get, the richer, the more complex the flavors get. It's exactly the same with barley malt. And Young's Double Chocolate Stouts, the reason that's double chocolate is if you toast barley grains to a very dark brown color, you will get chocolate and coffee notes from the barley. And so that's what some of the, so that's the first chocolate. Then the other chocolate is they've gone, well, that's a nice way. Let's just put some chocolate in as well. Let's put some actual chocolate in. So those are the two chocolates in Young's Double Chocolate Stout.
All right. I have a Founder's Breakfast Stout. It's a double chocolate, coffee, and oat milk stout, and that tells you what's in here. So you get lots of flavors, and it's really rich and flavor forward. And they added chocolate before fermentation and coffee beans after fermentation to infuse the beer with these flavors. But as it says, there's also oatmeal in this. And when you deal with roasted malts, you have also lots of roasted malt bitterness and acidity, and also some kind of astringency. But to soothe these, the harshness, to make it a bit more, give it more texture, brewers add oatmeal. And oatmeal is like, remember when you do a porridge, it becomes all slimy. And this kind of texture rounds off the edges of a stout in here. So that's what we can experience in this Founder's beer. And indeed, on the sides of your palate and your mouth, you can feel the creaminess.
That is the absolute difference between those two.
Yeah.
Because the more you toast the barley, the more you get this kind of bitter astringency. You know, it's a very different bitterness from hop bitterness. It's kind of a grainy bitterness. And you definitely get that grainy edge on this one.
Absolutely.
Whereas that's much smoother.
This is much smoother. It's also much more chewy. It's like almost drinking a hot chocolate or a Café Viennois, something like that. And this is lighter on the palate, but you have to deal with that dryness. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, stout scares a lot of people. I think as a style, when you get into beer, I think people find beers of this colour very easy to get into. And people are scared of the dark. People are afraid of the dark when it comes to beer. And people think that dark beers are going to be very forbidding. They're going to be very kind of aggressive. They're beers that you probably can't taste until you're a grown-up, mature, seasoned drinker. And I think that is a misconception, especially with something like that.
That's right. This is very pleasant and easy accessible, but still also lots of flavor. So it challenges you also in its complexity. We are at what? Oh, come on. There's a big ABV class.
There's a slight ABV difference, isn't there?
8.3. Where are you?
5.2.
Okay.
So that one actually, the 8.3 one is actually easier drinking than the 5.2 one. Just because of that texture, that mouthfeel. Yeah. I think that was smoother and creamy.
But, no, I like it. It's got something very delicious, some flowery note in the chocolate character.
Yeah, you just got that grin. I also find that when I spend a lot of time presenting beers to audiences where there'll be a male, usually male, beer fan who's dragged along his long-suffering female partner, and she's there on sufferance and says, well, I don't like beer. And the common wisdom when you're trying to get someone into beer is always start them off on the light stuff, see if they like that. then take them up to bigger flavours. And I often find that if you've got someone who drinks a lot of red wine, a lot of Shiraz, and they go, lager, no, I don't like that, no, pale ale, no. And you give them a beer like this, and they go, oh, yeah, I like that. That's really great. And you're like, well, that's kind of hardcore. Yeah. How can we yes. like that? It's like, well, it kind of reminds me of red wine. It's got that body. It's got that mouthfeel. It's good. It's got those kind of deep flavours.
Yeah, but that's the beauty of beer. The diversity is so vast, and you can find all kinds of flavours and great complexity. I'd like to mention this is a Founders beer. They are here in this alley on the left-hand side. And Founders is very, very... popular, no, very known for their Kentucky breakfast stout, KBS. This is not, this is a different version, but for KBS, people stand in lines in New York or so whenever that's on draft. So if you, so try that, and there are other beers, but they are really good at doing these dark ones.
I also love the idea of a breakfast stout. I think we should have more breakfast beers
yes.
on the market. I think that's a True. Great idea. It's not yeah. just a breakfast drink, but it can be...
Yeah, we need more drinking occasions for all this variety, I guess.
So we've got our barley wines left. We're going big.
We've got to do a proper presentation for this one.
Oh, yeah.
It's in the gift box.
So we're going UK first again. Fuller's are a long-standing London brewery from 1845. The word vintage has two different meanings in wine. It can mean the year. You know, this is the 2015 vintage ale we've got. Vintage can also mean this was a year that had particularly good ingredients. In wine, it's like this year is a vintage year because the grapes were particularly good. And so Fuller's Vintage Ale started off in 1997 as a way of celebrating the best hops and the best barley that were used by the brewery that year. So they said, oh, remember those brilliant hops we had back in May? Let's brew a beer with them. And they made it quite strong by British standards. I think it's 8.5. Yeah, 8.5%. And so they've made this beer every year since 1997. I've been lucky enough to go to tastings, to vertical tastings, where you start with a new release and then you work backwards and back and back and back to the original 1997. I don't think they have enough of the beers left now to do that. But what you notice about this beer as it ages is that it changes in character. There are quite a lot of hops in this beer. The 2016 will be still quite hoppy. I think the hops in this one will be starting to decline a little bit. I think you're probably going to get... Have we got one poured?
Oh, you need glasses.
We're going to get one. I would imagine you're going to get a slight bit of oxidation in this, that the malt character is going to start coming back through. You get more of kind of a port character to it. And as it ages, you start to taste that age more and more, and the beer starts to kind of fade a little bit. And then you get to about 5 or 6 years old, and it starts to come back, and it starts to taste fresher again. No one knows why, instead of just kind of going off a cliff like this, a beer like this will actually go like that. And over the years, different flavour elements will recede and come back. This beer is a living thing, and it's fascinating how the flavour changes over years.
So it's definitely fun aging beer, and you could do this also at home. Best suited are sours, we say from 6.5 ABV on. You need a little bit of alcohol content because that conserves, keeps the beer good, but then it can evolve. Okay, so this is...
It's the Fuller's?
It's the Fuller's.
Is it something about the bottle fermentation?
Yeah, bottle fermentation.
Yeah, this is also fermented in bottle. It's reseeded with yeast in the bottle. So it doesn't do much, because if it did do a lot, you'd be getting so much carbon dioxide, the bottle would explode, and the alcohol content would be shooting up. But what it does do is just enough fermentation to keep this beer alive. There's very slight residual yeast in the bottom. It's changing those flavour. People think about yeast. Yeast produces alcohol and carbon dioxide. Yeast also produces a lot of different flavour compounds. And yeast is massively underrated as a contributor of the flavour to beer. And this is where you really get it.
Yeah. Hop aroma is restrained. You get a nice dry fruits taste. Dry fruits.
That real dry fruit.
Wow. And then in the finish, there's still some good amount of bitterness and also resiny notes. So, and these might go when it ages further, the resinous
yes,
finish,
I think they would
right?
They would disappear. Well, not disappear, but turn into something else.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So for my finish, we also turn to a beer that is easy to age and can be aged very nicely. You can store it in your cellar and have different additions. But this is a barley wine, a bourbon barrel aged from a brewery that's here. It's a Pig Pounder from North Carolina. And they are up front in our beer section. And it's a beer, a barley wine. I will talk about barley wine later more, but for now, that has been aged in bourbon barrels. And this all came up in the 1990s. And a brewery named Goose Island, who is now, you know, overtaken by AB InBev, and you can see their beers at Aldi in the US, I heard. However, the very first one that did this was Bourbon County Stout, and it was, and the classic of barrel-aged beer is a stout in bourbon barrels. And here we have a barley wine in bourbon barrels. And barley wine is very, very British, a very British beer style. From what I know, and you might correct me later, barley wine was created when England and France were in conflict and they couldn't get hands on wines anymore. So especially for the noble people, they brewed a very, very strong beer. And barley wine means lots of malts, so that you can create higher ABVs, but you also get all the complexity of the malts. You get massive amounts of dry fruits or maybe toasted flavors, and it's just delicious. It's a delicious beer to do stuff with, aging or aging in barrels. And that's what the brewery has done, the brewers over there. Do you want to talk about your beer a little bit? Yes, Phil, come on. Give a hands. What's your name?
Marty.
Marty, come on. I forgot your name. So what did? How did you brew this?
Sure.
So
this is our barley wine. We've only been open for 2 years, so this is our first batch of it, and we're about out. You're having the last of the barley wine in existence, other than what we're laying down, and so you've got a very complex high ABV beer. You're picking up lots of different notes. I think this tastes like a holiday fruitcake, where you're getting dried fruits coming through, some nutty flavor. I think it's a very complex beer for a high ABV beer. We're aging it 14 months in bourbon barrels, and the bourbon barrels are coming from, or we're starting out with them with Heaven Hill, and they're a one-time use bourbon barrel, and they'll stay in there 14 months. And hopefully we'll have our second batch out soon, and you can try that at the next BCB.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
So was my story about barley wine true? Can you
I
add
think so.
Something?
So in the golden age, well, for the people who were lucky, in the golden age when we had great British country houses like Downton Abbey and places like that, every one of those big houses would have their brewery. Mm-hmm. And they would create their own beers for the dinner parties.
Yeah.
And yes, they wanted the kind of quick, easy running beers, but they also wanted beers that were laid down for years,
yeah.
that were vintage beers, that were that strong. You know, in order to lay them down, they had to be that strong. And I've read accounts from that period of people drinking a few glasses of these beers as if they were wine, and then falling over because they just had no idea how strong they were. Because, of course, when it's aging and it's carrying on fermenting, you don't know what's going to happen to it. It's you don't know,
yeah,
what you've got.
So what's the ABV in here?
So this is 11.5,
yeah,
I believe.
So
we're
in order to reach this high ABV, you take lots of malts, of course, but also at the stage of boiling, you boil for a long time to heighten the plato. So I've had barley wines that had been cooked for 8 hours. I don't know about this, but I mean, that's what effort it takes to create such a complex beer.
Absolutely. And there was a tradition, for a long time, there was a tradition of making these beers to celebrate royal births and royal birthdays. The Basque brewery in Burton-on-Trent used to make a lot of these very special beers, which, because they're so strong and so complex, if you find bottles of them on eBay, a lot of them are still drinkable, if the cork is still intact. I've had bottles of the 1902 King's Ale that Edward VII brewed, and it's interesting, but it's still drinkable. Yeah. And the last one that was made was a beer in 2002 to celebrate the Queen's Golden Jubilee.
Uh-huh.
And this was made in Burton-on-Trent. And about 8 years later, I was up visiting the brewer there who'd created that beer, and he was rummaging around in a storeroom, and he said, "Oh, I've just found some bottles of the Queen's Ale." And we were talking, there's a tradition about, we've been talking about the holiday pudding thing, the dried fruits, things like that. You make a Christmas pudding in the UK, stir up Sunday, 6 weeks before Christmas. You make your Christmas pudding mix and you pour in some barley wine or some stout. And I told this brewer that my wife was making a Christmas pudding. And he said, "Well, you must have some of the beer that goes in the Queen's Christmas pudding." Buckingham Palace asks for a bottle of this beer every year, but you have one to put in your Christmas pudding.
Wow.
And then he opened another bottle of the beer, and it was like this, and we're drinking it going, "Wow, I've never tasted beer like that before."
Yeah.
It was like, "Okay, so here's a bottle. Take this beer home to give to your wife to put into a pudding." And it's like,
No.
And I had this bottle on the train home. I had this bottle in front of me on the table. I was like, "It's good." And I got home and I was like, "Steve Wellington said I had to give you this." And my wife, bless her, she had a recipe that only used about that much of the beer. And as soon as she put it, I was like, "Get back here." But that is how special these beers are, I think.
Yeah, I don't want to see that in a pudding. I'd rather drink it. But let me point out and remind you, we are at 11 ABV and we have the complexity of a liquor here, of a bourbon or a rum or what have you. Wine only starts at 11 ABV, so never complain about beer being too high in alcohol. I don't want to hear that. Beer is the most delicious drink at the lowest ABV, alcoholic drink at the lowest ABV. And it can be that complex and delicious.
So we've not really...
Absolutely. Yeah.
So we've not really done a very good job of taking each other down, have we? this smackdown between British and American beer styles has been a loving of British and American beer styles.
We
really
are amazed, aren't we? Yes. At both sides.
Absolutely. I think that's it. Have you enjoyed the beers?
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Yeah. So I think the essence of this is keep trying. And no borders in beer, you know. Just keep trying and drinking one style or one brand is really old school. That was yesterday. Try new stuff and don't stop trying ever out new things. This is what the craft beer movement brought to us. And it's I think, Pete, and I know you agree, it's our task.
Absolutely.
That we cultivate diversity. Because if we don't do that, it's going away. It's our task to integrate new drinking occasions for this beer or this beer. It's not, you don't drink that, probably not at the same time in your life. Yeah.
Do we have any questions? Yes.
We've seen more and more beer in cans in craft beers. What do you think about this? We're seeing more and more beer in cans in craft beers. What do you think about this?
I first encountered craft beer in cans from an American brewer in Colorado. They virtually had to pin me to the floor, do that, and pour it down my throat.
You didn't smell them, didn't get the metal, did you?
No, I was like, no, that's going to taste shit. It's been in metal. It's going to taste metallic.
No.
I don't want to know.
No.
And then they gave, and I went, oh my God, that's fantastic. I think there's such, for drinkers of my age, there's such resistance to cans because they used to be horrible. Beer in cans used to taste nasty. Mm. And now the technology has changed and the can is the best format for craft beer.
Yeah.
It keeps the beer fresher, it's more environmentally friendly. Even a bottle like this allows some UV light to get into the beer and start breaking down the flavour compounds. There's no UV light getting into a can. It's hard to get your head around, but it is the best format for craft beer.
Okay, yes. No oxygen gets in and no light gets in. And also logistically, it's lighter and better to transport. The brewery you were talking about in the U.S. was Oscar Blues.
That's right.
So they started this whole thing in the early millennium, 2002 or so. They were the first microbrewery to can because they ball packaging invented a hand canning machine, so they could do that. And now we see this a lot in the U.S. And I think for the United States, when you have such a long way of transport, it makes sense. Here in Germany, I'm not so sure. It's smaller, and we have returnable bottles. I honestly don't know what has the better footprint or, you know, in environment questions. But it is a good container for beer, that's for sure. Personally, I like the style of bottles better. Especially at the table or so. You know, yes. For beer dinners, it's always nicer in a bottle.
Absolutely. Any other questions? Yes.
We're seeing the Quake farmhouse yeast exploding in Norway and the Nordic countries, finding yeast in small valleys. Is there any market that you're finding new yeast strains at the same sort? From different farmhouses that have been isolated in the same way.
Anything on farmhouse yeast in the States?
That's a huge trend in craft brewing, also in the United States. It's the mixed fermentation thing, and people harvest yeast, create their own yeast strains, or use different yeasts in one beer, different fermentation methods, spontaneous fermentation, or even in those very, let's say, rather simple sour styles like Berliner Weisse, you already have a mixed fermentation. You can have a mixed fermentation with beer yeast, lager or top fermented yeast, and then lactobacteria to create the sourness. So that's huge. And to my, what I think is that's endless. We will have a plethora of new tastes and varieties, because then you can also finish with another yeast in bottle conditioning. And I'm very much looking forward to those beers too.
I'm just finishing a book at the moment writing about the ingredients of beer, about hops, barley, yeast, and water. And in hops, in barley, and in yeast, if you look over 200 years, there's been so much effort put into, we need to refine our production of them, we need to enable consistency, we need to get better varieties, we need to make these ingredients better. And so breeding and cultivation is all about making them better and more consistent. And now we've got to the point where we have, with consistency, craft brewers around the world are going, I want the old stuff.
Yeah.
I want the really old, inconsistent yeast. I want the old hops. I want the heritage barley varieties that are really bad at kind of surviving pests and that kind of thing. And now we can have consistently clean and consistently sort of high standard beer. We want to know what the flaws are. Not even flaws. We want to know what the inconsistencies are. And a wild yeast, we will never be able to control a wild yeast.
Yes.
And so we want to know what that's like. You can brew with a Carlsberg yeast and brew the same beer again and again and again. What happens if the yeast changes? What happens if the yeast is in a bad mood? What happens if the yeast does something different? So I think that's going to be a real focus of craft beer in the next few years, definitely.
I'm really looking forward to your book, because when you talk to German brewers, for example, some mention that they use the old malt variety, and now talking about malts again, called Steffi, but they cannot explain you what that means. What that actually means is it's not such a high sugar bread exploitation kind of thing, but you have also more proteins, and so it's better for the brewer. It gives him more variation to design the style of the beer, I heard. So that's totally interesting what happens on the ingredient side. Absolutely. When does your book come out?
My book comes out in May 2017. Woo! Thank you very much for asking.
that's quite a while, but so next year you present it here.
Absolutely.
Very good.